Hi, I'm Allison Stewart, and this is an MTV News special, a tribute to Jerry Garcia, who was, of course, the Grateful Dead guitarist who died Wednesday morning, just 8 days after his 53rd birthday. The news of Garcia's passing traveled quickly and couldn't be avoided, a testament to his widespread and diverse following. Around 12 noon on Wednesday, Wall Street's Bloomberg News and stock quoting services crashed as word of Garcia's death reached brokers. In San Francisco, where Garcia was born, Mayor Frank Jordan had a tie-dyed flag flown at half-mast outside City Hall. The flag itself came from the legendary Haight-Ashbury district of San Francisco, from which the Dead emerged 30 years ago. All evidence of the generation-spanning appeal and impact of Garcia and the Grateful Dead. And that's why we'll be spending the next half hour looking back at Garcia's life and music through his colleagues, his peers, younger musicians influenced by the Dead, and the tie-dyed and true Deadheads themselves. The body of Jerome John Garcia, Jerry, was reportedly found at 4:23 a.m. Wednesday morning by a counselor at the Serenity Knowles Drug Treatment Facility in Northern California. While the coroner is conducting tests that won't be done for 2 weeks, the Marin County Sheriff announced that Garcia had died of natural causes. Grateful Dead publicist Dennis McNally told us he was surprised to learn Garcia was at the facility and said Garcia appeared to have suffered a heart attack. By Friday, reports were surfacing that with another Dead tour set for the fall, Garcia had checked into a rehab to battle a recurrent heroin habit, a problem that first went public with Garcia's San Francisco drug bust in 1987. The bearish Garcia had been suffering various health problems for the past several years and looked a lot older than 53. But in his time, he became one of rock's great guitarists and an icon of a band that not only symbolized the hippiness of the 60s, but outlasted and transcended that era. Here's a quick look back. From his spiraling sweet-toned guitar licks, you might never guess that Jerry Garcia had lost half of the middle finger on his right hand in an accident at age 4. With the Grateful Dead, Garcia would take a long, strange trip through rock history, during which Garcia became famous enough to have a flavor of ice cream named for him. And the Dead resolutely ignored trends and followed its own muse, which was equally at home with expansive improvisation or concise country's tune.
So this music comes off authentically as itself. That is to say, it's hard to say really what exactly it is. It's electric music with drums. It's like rock and roll, you know. It has the same instrumentation, but it's really Grateful Dead music, whatever that is.
With Garcia as main songwriter and lead instrumentalist, the Grateful Dead pioneered San Francisco's psychedelic rock sound in the late 60s. By the 1990s, the band, followed by several generations of Deadheads, was a thriving counterculture corporation, earning $15 to $20 million a year and placing in the top 20 of Forbes magazine's annual list of entertainment money makers. Everything was going along just fine until July of 1986, when Garcia, after undergoing drug treatment, slipped into a near-fatal diabetic coma for 5 days.
It is so weird to wake up in the hospital, you know, and find out later that you'd been out for many days, you know. And it's just, you know, what happened, you know? it's that kind of thing, and that's definitely strange. The rest of it has been mostly has exposed me to the tremendous depth of affection from Deadheads and all this concern, you know, that came pouring out of everywhere, you know.
The coma and an early 1987 drug bust were followed by the good news of the Dead surprise smash hit, That's Right. Then in August of 1992, the Dead had to cancel a tour for the first time ever when Garcia was hospitalized with lung disease and an enlarged heart. Garcia agreed to quit smoking, start exercising, and go on a diet.
I had some serious health problems, but it's nothing that that isn't reversible given lifestyle changes, and the threat of death is always a powerful incentive.
The Dead were back on the road in December of 1992 and seemed set to stay out there indefinitely. Despite Garcia's car accident last winter and a pinched nerve in his shoulder, suffered while scuba diving last March. Garcia had long since put the future in perspective.
I don't expect to live forever, you know what I mean, but geez, I don't know. I don't think about it very much. You know, it's just as long as it seems like there's things to do and that there's fresh possibilities and they keep popping up. And I mean, it's just years are flying by now, you know, just zip, zip, you know. I mean, it's just, but it doesn't, it's not at all dull, you know. And it hasn't even started to get, it's not even started to look like it's going to get that way.
Jerry Garcia leaves behind his wife of 18 months, Deborah Coons Garcia, and four daughters, aged 6 to 32, from previous relationships. A source close to us and the band told us there was a funeral on Friday. One of the most remarkable and remarked upon aspects of the Grateful Dead phenomenon is the sense of community the band helped foster among its legions of followers, the Deadheads, who trekked after the band from city to city on its seemingly endless tours. Wednesday night, from coast to coast, Deadheads gathered in public parks for spontaneous candlelight vigils in Garcia's memory, sharing their grief communally just as they'd enjoyed his music. We spoke with some of them in San Francisco and New York City.
He gave everything he had and just burned out at the end.
He captured all the best spirit of the human qualities, you know. He could make you laugh, cry, sing, you know, believe in God beyond a shadow of a doubt, you know. He was real.
Well, he just touched so many people, and he touched me, and it's a part of my history.
Even though he's gone, hopefully the spirit of the music and the peacefulness will live on.
I wish they would have some type of revival or at least try to continue it, because that was part of the whole thing, is going to the shows and hanging out and just joining everybody. It was all peaceful.
We just wanted to come down to pay respect, kind of, to Jerry. My mom and I are Deadheads.
It's like I feel like I've lost a lot of, like, a big part of my youth, and that's really what he represents to me.
The songs are about basic things in life. Love, you know, life was, it was all about how people were feeling, how every people of all ages feel the same thing. It's the truth, and that's what they sang.
Other people, I think, feel the same way, that Jerry was, you know, talking to me and helped me straighten out a lot of things in my life just by being there and listening to the music and dancing. That's what it's all about.
They sound like old hippie values, but peace and love and music were, that, you know, to me, the three central things that Jerry Garcia promoted.
Going to a show is, it's a microcosm of something that isn't available in most people's everyday life. And to have that, and now it's gone.
I actually received my fall tickets this morning. It's kind of beat.
I got up this morning with my coffee and checked my email and noticed there were about, you know, 75 letters there.
I cried like he was like my father, like he was like somebody real close to me.
I'm sad that nobody else in future generations got to see it.
I went to some shows pregnant, and some people would say, oh, you should bring your kids to shows, and I just wanted to wait till they were a little bit older, and I kind of regret it now.
I think the Dead as a band are done. I mean, we're a tour. You know, maybe they'll tour in different incarnations like they always have, but they'll never call themselves the Grateful Dead again. It would be a sham if they did.
For many, it seems inconceivable that the Grateful Dead would continue touring without Garcia. And when we asked publicist Dennis McNally about that on Wednesday, he could only say, quote, I don't know. As we went to tape this show Friday evening, the band had yet to issue a statement about its future. Arista Records reportedly has a double live Grateful Dead album recorded in Germany set for release this October. There'll also be released a Deadhead documentary film called Tie-Dyed, Rock and Roll's Most Dedicated Fans. And by the way, the term Deadhead was not coined for the band's followers. It goes back to the Middle Ages, when alchemists used it to describe the residue of distillation. By the mid-19th century, Deadhead had come to mean one who travels free, eats free, or especially goes free to a place of entertainment. Over a century later, the Dictionary of American Slang and Colloquial Expressions included the definition, a follower of the Grateful Dead rock group. That information comes from the book Skeleton Key, A Dictionary for Deadheads, whose co-author David Shank will join us after the break when our tribute to Jerry Garcia returns. We'll also have reactions to Garcia's death from some musicians such as Blues Traveler and the Red Hot Chili Peppers, Dave Matthews, and Carlos Santana. Don't go away. Sure, but before that, he gave this statement to the media.
Well, I guess some sad news has come our way. This morning, Jerry Garcia, our friend, my brother, passed away. And I guess not much can be said about that, except that perhaps it's a big loss for the for the world, for anyone who loves music, we also have to remember that his life was far more a blessing for all of us. And I think we should, perhaps, if we're going to dwell on anything, dwell on that. Thank you.
Carlos Santana, another guitar great who emerged from San Francisco in the late 60s, said he was, quote, deeply saddened to hear that my good friend of three decades has passed from this earth. The Dave Matthews Band, which seemed to tour as hard as the Dead, said that, quote, playing with the Dead earlier this year was one of the most moving experiences we've had as a band. Our hearts go out to family, friends, and fans on this tragic day. And Bob Dylan, who's toured several times with the Dead since 1987, called Garcia, quote, more like a big brother than a friend. Garcia's death also affected younger musicians, from the Red Hot Chili Peppers to the acts on the Horde Tour, whose tie-dye jamming spirit evokes the Dead. The Black Crowes and Blues Traveler and Company played Portland, Maine Thursday night, and we were there.
Yesterday was pretty shitty for us, so hopefully we can make some music and get a thing going, you know?
Cried over somebody dying before, ever. And I was up all night last night, and I cried. Boy, did I cry. I never knew it would touch me so much.
We've lost such a peace legend. It's so bad. It's like the worst thing I've heard in so long.
It's like the fall of an icon. Nobody, you can't compare Jerry Garcia to anybody. You could try to compare him to Lennon, maybe, Morrison, but you still can't, you know? Jerry Garcia had his own style of playing, and that's gone forever.
I think probably, maybe for once, rock and roll will be legitimized in a sense that he'll be treated more as an artist than just like a pop icon, you know? And that's a testament to the man's work, you know?
What we're gonna have is a moment of silence for Jerry Garcia. And we want you all to do it with us. So,
each show, each year that you go to builds a little bit of yourself. And it's hard to lose somebody like Jerry. You lose a lot of yourself when it happens.
I know that for my family, he brought us all together. He was somebody that we could all relate to. And I think that's the legacy he's going to leave behind. He was able to bring everybody together.
Meanwhile, across the country at a video shoot in California, the Red Hot Chili Peppers had this to say of Garcia's passing.
He was a tremendously talented guitar player. When I was a kid, I used to actually follow the Dead. And some would say that that's what led me to the most f***ed up life that I've ever had, and some would say that's what opened my mind. I don't know, you know, but he will be sadly missed.
To me, it really feels like the 60s are now, like, officially over. And what are all the Deadheads going to do now? What are they going to do? They're going to be bummed. I think everyone's bummed.
That was such a unique entity, the Grateful Dead. I mean, I don't think the Grateful Dead were part of a movement or a wave or a genre or a category or anything like that. So I don't think it signals the end of a particular era. It's a personal era.
Chili Peppers bring up some good points, which we're going to put to David Shank, who is a co-author of the book Skeleton Key, a dictionary for Deadheads. David, thanks for joining
us.
Sure. Quick question. Jerry Garcia as guru, obviously Deadheads loved his music, but what did he offer them spiritually that they were able to get from him?
Well, Jerry was such a deeply humble person, and he had that bittersweet quality in his voice. He had a real fragility, a sense of the fragility of life. When he sang really sad songs, you could hear just a tinge of optimism in them. And when he sang really joyful songs, there was a little bit of sadness in there, too. So I think that really touched people. He was also a true intellectual. He was just a really curious person. And listening to the Dead was sort of like an adventure in one's mind. You just made all sorts of connections of ideas that's exactly what the band was doing on stage also, so you were sort of sharing that with them.
He's probably more interested, it seems like he's more interested in the progression of thought and music rather than being the leader of the Dead. It wasn't a place he was real happy with.
Yeah, he always said he didn't want to be a leader of anything, and people were just drawn to his charisma, and he had to live with that, but it gave him a great platform to do what he loved. But he always did say that process was what it was for him, not any goal.
Now the process of being the Dead turned into something so amazingly huge. It's a very big family, but is the Dead dead? I mean, what's going to happen?
Well, the Grateful Dead, as we know it, is certainly gone. Mm-hmm. Someone said on the internet, what a long, strange trip it was.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, there is a huge corporation there, a big family business that the Dead had. That was dependent on a lot of tour revenue, mm-hmm. and maybe they'll decide to do some sort of postscript to the Grateful Dead and take it out on the road for a while. I have no idea. I'm sure they don't even know yet.
But there is a legacy. I mean, there are bootlegs, and what do you think is going to happen with all that other material that he left behind?
Yeah, I mean, this is such a great loss, but Jerry gave us so much in his life, and I think he maybe has the largest legacy of any musician in sheer volume, certainly.
Sure.
That's true. There's thousands of hours of show tapes,
uh-huh.
Many of them great quality, all available for trade. You don't even have to pay for most of them. Just a lot of almost infinitesimal amount of really beautiful music that we'll always have the tapes.
Let's think about the tapes.
Yeah.
Thanks, David, for joining
sure.
us. The name of the book is The Skeleton Key, A Deadhead's Guide. It's time for us to take one more pause, but our special tribute to Jerry Garcia will return. Don't go away. We'll take you to this break with one of the last things that Garcia did, a version of Smoke Gets in Your Eyes from the soundtrack of the acclaimed movie Smoke.
Well, I'm loving the same times. Smoke gets in your eyes.
Welcome back to our MTV News special, A Tribute to Jerry Garcia. The late guitar great was a multifaceted talent whose accomplished paintings not only hung in galleries around the world, but also graced a line of high-fashion neckties. Some of Garcia's art went on display Thursday night in a previously scheduled exhibit of LSD blotter paper art at the Art Rock Gallery in San Francisco. On hand were Dr. Timothy Leary, one of the earliest proponents of mind expansion through psychedelic drugs, an idea Garcia also endorsed, and Stanley Mouse, whose artwork has graced several Grateful Dead album covers, and who had a very personal reason for missing Jerry Garcia.
He came by my house a couple of times. We drank beer, just talked. Probably we may have smoked some funny cigarettes, I don't know. And I would meet him often kind of on the road. As a matter of fact, there was a hotel in New York called the Chelsea Hotel that impoverished people ended up. And I used to spend time with the Grateful Dead there.
3 years ago, I was in the hospital dying from hepatitis C, and my liver was giving out. And actually, I had gone into a coma and woke up with a new liver. And the story was that I heard that I had 24 hours to live, and Jerry and the Grateful Dead gave the okay to, they said they would finance it, and I got a new liver out of the deal. And so I feel pretty close to Jerry for pulling me through. I wish I could have done the same for him.
That art show will be up through September at the Art Rock Gallery on Mission Street in San Francisco. A tribute to Jerry Garcia would not be complete without some extended sound bites from the man himself. They are rare. Garcia did not give interviews too often, but when he did, he was found to be charming, funny, candid, and very intelligent. Back in 1987, not long after Garcia had recovered from his diabetic coma, he discussed his status in the Grateful Dead, the band's music-making process, and the origins of its cooperative attitude towards the taping of shows by audience members.
Jerry Garcia always found musical collaboration more interesting than trying to further a singular artistic vision. And while the fans and general public considered him the focal point of the Grateful Dead, Garcia always scoffed at any suggestion that he was the band's leader.
Are you kidding? I couldn't lead these guys anywhere. No, they won't. They know me too well, you know. So it doesn't work that way. It's the way it works is, say on a piece of music, a tune or something like that, somebody will come in with their tune and say, here's the song, here's the way it goes. And that means, really, here's the melody, here's the lyrics, and here's the chord changes. And here's the feeling. And if they have some ideas about, I want to hear one of these kind of, a sound like this, when this happens or something like that, they'll bring up whatever ideas. Sometimes the ideas are quite complex, sometimes they're very simple. But the thing is that nobody will do what anybody tells them to, you know. See, that's the way it works in the Grateful Dead. But people will say, yeah, that's a pretty good idea, but I think I can come up with something better, you know. And eventually it turns into something that's not what you wrote, you know, specifically. But you have to learn to trust the process. I mean, if you're really in love with your own ideas, the Grateful Dead will kill you, you know. So it's one of those things where you have to be willing to let your material be transmuted by these guys, you know, these crazy people, you know. Hey, they're taking my music and making it really weird, you know. So it's just, I mean, it's a thing that you either accept it or you don't belong here. It's that simple.
The Grateful Dead flew in the face of industry convention through their policy of encouraging fans to record and trade in bootleg tapes. For Garcia, his enthusiasm for the taping phenomenon began back in his pre-Grateful Dead days.
Collecting is a whole thing, you know, which is, I sympathize somewhat. I used to tape bluegrass music, so I used to be a guy running around with tape. You know, I sympathize with that. And back when I was taping bluegrass music, they used to have, and a lot of the places where they had bluegrass music, which were these outdoor parks, they have them spread through the South and the kind of Midwest, there where people go on the weekend, like Sunday afternoon, and they bring picnic lunch and the family, and it costs like $1, you know. And they come, and there's like a half a dozen acts, most of them local, but there'll be one group, say, from the Grand Ole Opry, one headliner. The rest of them will be local pickers and stuff like that, and families and what have you. And they a lot of these places have rows of outlets right on the stage. So people bring their tape recorders and plug right in, you know. This goes on all the time. It's the coolest thing in the world, you know. I thought, wow, what a great idea when I was a taper, you know. And I always thought, well, if people want to tape our music, that's fine, you know. Cause, I mean, when we're finished with it, it's gone, you know. If somebody wants to tape it and collect it, whatever, that's okay.
Jerry Garcia, he's gone, but his music lives on. And that'll do it for the tribute to Jerry Garcia. Stay tuned to MTV News for any further developments regarding Garcia memorials and the Grateful Dead status. We'll leave you now with what the Dead's official videographer, Justin Kreutzmann, son of drummer Bill Kreutzmann, told us was Garcia's favorite of the few videos he'd made. A rarely seen clip for a version of B.B. King's The Thrill Is Gone, recorded with his longtime friend and collaborator, mandolin player David Crispin.
The thrill is gone. The thrill is gone away. The thrill is gone. Sorry someday.
Beavis and Butthead are not role models.